So now we're going to start with chemical control and coordination. Okay, so this deals with all your hormones. So you have to remember which hormone produced by which organ doing what function. So these are the main points which you have to learn. So when I say hormonal system, what are hormones? They are chemical messengers. Okay, they are non-nutrient entities. They are chemical messengers which will pass on the message from brain to other parts. Okay. See, brain is connected to your other parts by two means. One is your neuronal control, okay? Direct signals, this is your acetylcholine and other things. The other one is through your chemical system, hormonal system, okay? Impulse, electrical system, and chemical system is your hormonal system. So you have two types of glands, as you know, exocrine and endocrine. Exocrine are the glands with ducts, and endocrine are ductless glands, okay? So that is the what is endocrine gland is that their contents are directly poured in the blood and blood carries them and transmits to that particular region. Okay, so that type of gland is called as endocrine gland. Now we are going to see about what are the endocrine glands present, how is the regulation happening. Okay, now pituitary gland is said to be the master gland because this gland controls the entire chemical or hormonal system. But the pituitary gland itself is controlled by a region in your brain called as hypothalamus. Okay, so hypothalamus controls pituitary. Pituitary controls the entire hormonal system. So let's see how is it controlling, what are the hormones produced by your hypothalamus. Okay, now to see about hypothalamus. Hypothalamus produces whatever is released by hypothalamus is called as releasing factors. Okay, whatever hormones are by pituitary, you call it as tropic hormones. So with the name you can differentiate. Okay, if I say releasing factor, it is from the hypothalamus. If I say tropic hormones, it is from the pituitary. Okay, now what are all the secretions of the hypothalamus? Okay, hypothalamus controls pituitary in two ways. Okay. One is, see, you have two regions in pituitary. Anterior pituitary, the other one is posterior pituitary. Hypothalamus controls your anterior pituitary by chemicals, that is through hormones. Hypothalamus controls your posterior pituitary by electrical signals. Correct? Is it clear? Anterior pituitary is controlled by secretion of some hormones, but posterior pituitary is directly controlled, okay, by electrical signals or electrical impulses. Okay, the anterior pituitary is called as adenophysis and the posterior pituitary is called as neurohypophysis. Okay, so these are two areas of your pituitary gland. Now, let's see what are the hormones secreted by your hypothalamus. Okay, this for controlling your anterior pituitary. Okay. Okay. So, it secretes the following hormones. So I'll call them as releasing factors. Okay, I call the secretions of your pituitary as releasing factors. So one is okay. I'll just put it in a flowchart because I have to write the functions also. So I hope this part is clear. I'm erasing this off and I'm going for the names. Okay. So you have to know this thing. This question has been asked once. The control of posterior pituitary is electrical. That means your posterior pituitary is not secreting anything, but the posterior pituitary secretion is nothing but the secretion of your hypothalamus. Okay. Okay. Now, what are the hormones secreted by hypothalamus? One is GnRH. Okay. Sorry, GHRH. Growth hormone, releasing hormone. Okay, then GHIH, growth hormone, inhibiting hormone. Okay, then your G GnRH, gonadotropin releasing hormone. Okay, CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone. Then TRH, thyrotropin releasing hormone. Melanotin or melanotropin, melanin releasing hormone. Okay, so these are the hormones produced by your hypothalamus. I repeat, growth hormone releasing hormone, growth hormone inhibiting hormone, gonadotropin hormone, corticotropic hormone, thyrotropic hormone, and melanocyte releasing hormone or melanin releasing hormone. So these are the hormones produced by the hypothalamus. Okay, so this is directly going to go and hit your anterior pituitary. Okay, so what happens is, so okay, let's see how is this impacting. When GnRH hits your anterior pituitary, then your anterior pituitary will release your growth hormone. Growth hormone or somatotropin. Okay, so your anterior pituitary will release growth hormone when GnRH hits. When growth hormone inhibiting hormone is called as somatostatin. Tropin is growth hormone, statin is inhibiting hormone. When this is released by your hypothalamus, the production of this is stopped. Okay, fine. Next, when GnRH is released, okay, my anterior pituitary will release, okay, it has got, see, gonadotropin releasing hormone, or now what I'm going to say is, I will call them as gonadotropins. Okay, so what are these gonadotropins? It's nothing but your FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, and LH. Okay, and in males you call it as interstitial cell stimulating hormone. These three are the gonadotropins. Okay, now when CRH hits your anterior pituitary, then it produces your adrenocorticotropic hormones. When CRH hits your anterior pituitary, pituitary will produce ACTH. Okay, when TRH hits your anterior pituitary, this produces TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. When melanin releasing hormone hits it, this produces melanin. Okay, melanocyte or melanin. So I repeat, GHRH, this will go and produce growth hormone, which is somatotropin. This will inhibit the production of your growth hormone. GnRH, gonadotropins are released, FSH, ICH, and LH, follicle stimulating hormone, interstitial cell stimulating hormone, and luteinizing hormone. Then when CRH hits, it produces adrenocorticotropic hormones. When TRH hits, it produces TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. And when this, it's melanin. Okay, now, this directly acts, and this will help in the growth regulation. Fine, the story is over. This is stimulated, this will inhibit. Okay, now coming to your FSH. FSH will act on testis and ovary. Okay, so you have your, this is hitting this, this is the ones inside the box are your organs. Pituitary gland, okay, testis or ovary. Okay, so, and then your ICTH will act on testis. And this acts ovary and testis. Okay, so FSH will make your testis and ovary produce, okay, overall. They help in sperm production and they help in the production of four hormones, two female and two male hormones. There is nothing but your progesterone. We've seen in detail in reproduction. Okay. So estrogen, then your testosterone and your androgen. So gonadotropins will help in the production of these four hormones: estrogen, progesterone, androgen and testosterone. Okay, these are the four tropin hormones which are produced. See, FSH will help mainly in the development of the follicle, okay, and it also helps in the production of estrogen. LH will help in the production of progesterone. So the temporary endocrine gland which produces your progesterone is nothing but the, I hope you remember, corpus luteum. Okay, so initially there will be from this levels, but as it goes on during pregnancy, corpus luteum takes the, corpus luteum will start producing the progesterone. Then your androgen and testosterone. Okay, these hormones are responsible for the secondary sexual characters in a male and female also. Okay, now let's see about ACTH. Okay, let's see about this later. Corticotropin hormones, let's see about this later. Then coming to your TSH. TSH will go and hit your thyroid gland. Okay, and it makes your thyroid to produce three hormones: T3, T4, and thyrocalcitonin. Sorry. Triiodothyronin, tetraiodothyronin, and thyrocalcitonin. So when there is iodine deficiency in the water, okay, so that will end up in causing your thyroid deficiencies, like your goiter, hypothyroidism, all these simple goiter, all these are the thyroid deficiencies. Okay, growth hormone, the deficiencies are gigantism and dwarfism. Okay, so gigantism is gigantism and dwarfism, both in case, the person will be mentally stable, but only the growth will vary. He is not mentally retarded. Okay, so only the growth didn't happen. So that is why you call it as dwarfism. Okay, and cretinism. There is one more case called as cretinism. Okay, so in that case, the child will be mentally affected. He'll be mentally retarded. Okay, so that case happens when the mother is having the, if she is hypothyroid, then if she conceives, then the baby will be affected and that will end up in cretinism. Okay. But here, in growth hormone abnormalities, the person will be mentally normal. There is no mental disability. Okay. Only the growth is disabled. Okay. So, these two are iodine hormones. And thyrocalcitonin is your peptide hormone. So, these are the hormones released by your thyroid gland after stimulation by TSH and TRH. Hypothalamus releases TRH, TRH hits pituitary and pituitary releases TSH. Then TSH will hit the thyroid gland and results in the production of these three hormones. And this melanin is related to your skin. Okay, so now, so this is all about the regulation. ACTH I'll explain you separately. Okay, and apart from this, you have some two other extra hormones. Okay, so I've told you the function of this, right? T3 and T4, they are helpful, they are needed for the thyroid metabolism. Okay. See, if thyroid is produced beyond the normal quantity, hyperthyroidism, then it will increase the metabolism and the person will be very lean. Okay. Hyperthyroids will be lean. Hypothyroids will be fat, because when thyroid is produced less, the metabolism is reduced, so the person will gain weight. Okay. This thyrocalcitonin, okay, the name says calcitonin. This deals with, increases the calcium levels in your blood. Okay, so this mainly encounters with increasing your calcium levels in blood. Okay, so this thyrocalcitonin increases the calcium levels in your blood. Okay, so from where? So this will make your bone lose its calcium. So it actually decreases your bone density. Okay, from the bone, the calcium is released into the blood. So that is the function of the thyrocalcitonin. Okay, now let's see about pineal gland. There's one more gland. So there is no stimulation for this because this is present in the brain itself. So there is no need to be a stimulation. This pineal gland will release a hormone called melatonin. That is melanin, this is melatonin. Okay. This melatonin is responsible for maintaining your regular, you have an internal cycle. Okay. So you have a rhythm. For example, if you start eating at 8 o'clock daily, obviously the fourth day or fifth day you tend to be hungry because you've set up a cycle. So that internal cycle and internal balance is maintained by your melatonin. Okay, so melatonin is very important. Some people, when they're coming from US and all, they'll have that jet lag, right? That's because of this hormone only. Okay, so melatonin is a hormone. Then you have something called parathyroid gland. This is found just beyond your thyroid gland. Okay, so this will produce a hormone called as parath hormone. This will produce a hormone called parath hormone. This parath hormone will function in the opposite way to that of thyrocalcitonin. For example, thyrocalcitonin will increase calcium levels. This will decrease the calcium levels in blood and it increases calcium levels in bone. Okay, so these two hormones function in an opposite way. Okay, fine. Next is that parathyroid gland and parath hormone. Next comes your pancreas. Pancreas acts both as exocrine and endocrine gland because the exocrine function is pancreatic juice and the endocrine function is your production of hormones like insulin and glucagon. So we've seen about this in digestion and everything, right? So I just want to summarize. Insulin is produced by beta cells and glucagon is produced by alpha cells. So insulin converts your, insulin will help in conversion of glucose and it is stored. Okay. Glucagon breaks it and again takes it back. Okay. So glucose is converted into glycogen. Glycogen is broken down back to glucose. So this is a process. Okay. After pancreas. So pancreas is called as mixed gland. Okay. So it is both endocrine and exocrine. So I call it as mixed gland. And the last one is your ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone. So this will go and stimulate the organ called as the adrenal gland, which is located on the kidney. Okay. So let's see how it stimulates. Okay. There are two regions in the adrenal gland. One is adrenal cortex and the other one is adrenal medulla. Okay. So it will go and hit your adrenal gland. Okay. So this has two regions. Adrenal, medulla, and then adrenal cortex. Okay. Now, adrenal medulla, okay, this will produce the hormones called as catecholamines. That is nothing but your epinephrine and norepinephrine. So you call it as hormones of fright and flight, okay, or adrenaline and noradrenaline. These are called collectively called as catecholamines, and this is produced by your adrenal medulla. Okay. So this is the emergency hormones. This is also called as emergency hormones. Okay. Now coming to your adrenal cortex. Okay. Your adrenal cortex will produce two types of hormones. One is mineralocorticoids and glucocorticoids. Okay. The mineralocorticoid which is produced, the glucocorticoid which is produced is nothing but your cortisol. And the mineralocorticoid which is produced is nothing but your aldosterone. Okay, so I repeat, so medulla produces catecholamines, hormones of fright and flight. Okay, they are emergency hormones and that's it. Cortex, mineralocorticoids, aldosterone, they help in maintaining your water balance. Okay, so when aldosterone is an important enzyme, which a hormone which helps in maintaining your water balance. And cortisol is also helpful in glucose metabolism. Cortisol will regulate the blood glucose levels along with your insulin. This also helps in regulating your blood glucose levels. So this has more role in glucose metabolism and this has more role in your water balance. Okay, so aldosterone and cortisol. Okay. We've seen till the adrenal gland. Okay, so I think we've seen growth hormone. Next is your gonadotropins. Then next is your ACTH, adrenal cortex medulla. Medulla, epinephrine, norepinephrine, cortex will produce your glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids. Next we have seen is about your thyroid hormones, T3, T4 and calcitonin. Then your melanin. And the last one is that we have seen some extra hormones there. One is your pineal gland produces melatonin. Then your parathyroid gland will produce parathormone, which is totally in reversal effect of your thyrocalcitonin. Okay, and then we've seen about your pancreas, correct? Now we're going to see about the hormones out of the posterior pituitary. So as I told you, hypothalamus will directly control the posterior pituitary. There aren't any hormones to control. Okay, so actually the hormones released, there are only two hormones released by your posterior pituitary. One is your vasopressin and oxytocin. So these are the two hormones released by your posterior pituitary, or it is called as antidiuretic hormone. Aldosterone maintains a water balance. ADH also is important in maintaining your water balance for water reabsorption. Okay, now, so these hormones are produced in hypothalamus and released by pituitary. Okay, so it is produced there and it will send the signals to the pituitary and pituitary will release these two hormones. Okay, now what is the function of the vasopressin? I told you, reabsorption of water from tubules in the kidney. Okay, so the nephron tubules, in that tubules the reabsorption of water is mainly because of your ADH. And oxytocin will help in contraction of uterus during childbirth. And oxytocin will also help in ejection of milk. Milk production, prolactin. Milk ejection, oxytocin. And also it helps in the contraction of uterus during childbirth. So this is all about your posterior pituitary hormones. Okay, now what are we going to see is about your types of hormonal regulations. First of all, you have to know about the types of hormones. Okay, there are two types of hormones. One is synergistic hormones. Synergistic means these hormones will complement each other. When one is raising, the other one will also raise. When one is decreasing, the other one will decrease. The next is your antagonistic hormones. I repeat, synergistic hormones is one. Next one is your antagonistic hormones. Synergistic hormones will complement each other. Antagonistic hormone will suppress each other. Okay. For example, we've seen, right, thyrocalcitonin and parathormone. These two are antagonistic. Insulin, glucagon, antagonistic. Somatotropin, somatostatin, antagonistic. So these are the antagonistic hormones. Synergistic hormones, I would say, prolactin and progesterone. Estrogen and progesterone. So these are the hormones wherein the levels will raise when the other levels will raise. So these are synergistic hormones. Okay. And the last topic is based on the chemical nature, you have many types of hormones, like your peptides, polypeptides, etc. Then is your steroids, then your thyroid hormones. These are the three types of hormones based upon their chemical nature. Peptide hormones, all your pituitary hormones, okay, then your all your pituitary hormones are peptide hormones. Then your growth hormone, okay, and then your corticotropin hormones, all these are peptide hormones. Steroid hormones are your sexual hormones, progesterone, estrogen, testosterone, and these are the steroid hormones. That is, they'll have little amount of steroids, that is a fat derivatives or fat associates with them. And thyroid hormones or iodine hormones is your T3 and T4. It's called as iodohormones. It's not thyroid, I'm sorry. It's iodotropins. So this is nothing but your T3 and T4. These are the types of hormones. Now, all the hormones will not act in the same way. Okay. First thing is, the hormone should influence the cell, correct? So how can they influence? Okay, so first let's see how will the peptide hormones do. Okay, so what happens is that if this is your cell has nucleus, and inside the nucleus you will have your DNA, correct? So what will peptide hormones do is, peptide hormones have no permission to enter your cell. They cannot enter the cell and directly pass in the message. No, they can't do that. So what they'll do is, they'll come to the surface of the cell and they will transfer the information to your secondary messengers. See, if I have no permission to enter your class, what will I do? I'll just call somebody and I'll pass the information. Same thing. That somebody through whom I'm passing the information is your secondary messengers. Okay, your secondary messengers are cyclic AMP, Enosin, triphosphate, all these are some of your secondary messengers. Okay. But whereas your steroid hormones, this is your DNA, correct? So steroid hormones will directly enter the DNA and they will make the change. Okay. But peptide hormones, they have no permission to enter the cell. So they will regulate the action through your secondary messengers, whereas steroids will directly enter the cell. So that these are the two mechanisms through which your cell is regulated. Clear? I mean, hormones will regulate your cell. One is direct stimulation like steroids, the other one is through the secondary messengers. Okay, so with this, we are done with human physiology.